Hi everybody, today is May 28, 2013. Yeah, I'm back. By popular demand or angry mobs, whichever you want to call it. Here's an article I thought you would like. Fear of catastrophic events is now worryingly mainstream. My catastrophism started with childhood terror of nuclear attack, but now we live in fear. Let's focus on the road ahead. Disease without cure ravages Florida citrus. Plagues of locusts blanket Madagascar. These headlines plucked from my daily paper have an almost biblical ring. But we catastrophists usually place no stock in apocalyptic visions. Apocalypse is the final reckoning and divine judgment, the end of days, and the four horsemen. Believers in apocalypse plan their social schedule by the Mayan calendar. They see God's justice in the formation of funnel clouds and detect punishment in the spread of plagues. We catastrophists, by contrast, are mostly a secular lot. Where the apocalyptists see patterns, the catastrophicist sees the terrifying work of randomness. Apocalypticism foretells the ultimate restoration of order. Catastrophicism imagines its sudden, radical disruption. Perhaps not the end of life, but a tearing asunder of happily patterned existence. Nature is hardly the catastrophicist's principal menace. In the wake of the earthquake of 1755 that devastated Lisbon, Rousseau rebuked the citizens of Portugal for having slapped together tall, rickety buildings vulnerable to disasters. Where others saw God's hand, Rousseau glimpsed the failings of his fellow humans, people guilty of greed, corruption, and negligence. Like Rousseau, the catastrophicist wonders where natural disasters end and man-made calamities begin. Think climate change. Think superbug. Think improbable event. A planet-destroying terror in space-time, triggered by CERN's Large Hadron Collider. These nightmares leave untouched the range of looming catastrophes born of human hate and malice. My own catastrophe began at an early age. As a child, I would lie in bed waiting to be vaporized by a thermonuclear attack. A clap of thunder became a sonic boom of a Russian strategic bomber come to deliver death from above. A flash of lightning signaled the detonation of a 10-megaton warhead. My youthful terrors might have been extreme, but the Zegatists have since caught up with and even surpassed my catastrophism. If I now spend my hours on the train checking the overhead luggage rack for orphaned suitcases, I'm not indulging a private paranoia, but simply fulfilling a civic function. If I recently spent a day sheltered in place, doors locked and curtains drawn, it's not because I was genuinely worried about the destructive powers of a single wounded 19-year-old. I'm just obeying my governor's orders. If I maintain a stockpile of water and freeze-dried food in my basement, it's not because I'm a crackpot survivalist. I'm just dutifully following the list of recommendations helpfully posted on the website of the Department of Homeland Security. Indeed, compared to the catastrophism that finds expression in ready.gov, I might be accused of insolence in the face of peril. I've yet to buy the NOAA weather radio with tone alert that FEMA recommends for all households. And my supply of batteries is low, and frankly, those that I have haven't been tested in months. My duct tape is 3 years old and may be losing its stick. I don't keep paper copies of my bank statement. I haven't installed a high-efficiency particle air filter in my home's heating system that the government assures me would filter out biological agents in the 0.3 to 10 micron range. And I never even participated in a local National Preparedness Day despite the promise of waterproof matches and a free whistle. Recently, I found myself beginning to worry about all this catastrophism. I live in a lovely New England town with towering sugar maples and white clapboard houses. During my daily 12-mile drive to Amherst, where I teach, I often have to swing into the opposite lane to negotiate a vast course of potholes that crater the road and that the town doesn't have the money to fix. But along the way, I pass no fewer than 5 state-of-the-art CCTV cameras affixed to the top of traffic lights, courtesy of Homeland Security. As comforted I am by the notion that these cameras will track the flow of terrorists across our local asparagus fields, I wonder if our focus on preparedness isn't perhaps causing us to lose sight of other things along the way. No one would call a pothole catastrophic. Thoughts of potholes don't rob us of sleep or vex us into nightmares. But instead of watching the skies for asteroids, maybe it's time we catastrophics begin to spend a bit more time looking at the road directly ahead. So what is the road ahead? Government ways so they can't fix the potholes, where they cut government programs for child care or housing for the disabled and needy? Maybe we should focus on things that we can try and fix instead of things that we have no control over, such as solar flares and asteroids. We all should be prepared for any type of disaster, but maybe if we focus on things that we can do something about, we might have a little peace of mind. So they cut programs, and yet they're spending $12,090,400,000 to enlarge an Air Force base where the island does not have the environment to sustain. They don't have enough water. It's going to damage the ecosystem. And while they spend money on programs of weapons of war, they don't fix the potholes. They don't improve our schools. But they always seem to find the money to develop weapons of war and overthrow governments and spy on its own United States citizens. Maybe the road ahead that's full of potholes is actually the political people that are in government. All right, bookmark my site. I'll keep you up to date. Please stay safe, and I'll talk to you later. God bless y'all. Bye.